Even the Philips was relatively successful with the compact cassette, but it didn't bring much money to the kitchen because of the free license. Therefore, when the digital technology became sufficiently advanced, they thought there is an opportunity and time for a home digital tape recorder. They wanted to make it cheaper than the competing DAT already on the market, which was mostly aimed at studio use. The intended principles of the development are compatibility with the compact cassette, the quality should be comparable to the CD, playing time similar to the cassette, mechanically simple, possibility of a copy protection. The latter was due to pressure from the music industry. But the other conditions arose from Philips' thinking. Almost every household has one or two cassette recorder, for which they buy a cassette every year. Compatibility with these provides a market continuity and a nice transition from analog to digital. It was calculated that, with the support of the music industry, in about 15 years, DCC will be the most popular format. DCC was eventually supported by Matsushita and was introduced in 1992. But the device is finally only manufactured by Philips, Technics, Marantz and Grundig. Sony has completely avoided to support DCC because to favor of their own DAT and minidisc format. In 1992, it was presented at CES in Chicago and Amsterdam.
Philips vindt de muziekcassette uit en tijden veranderen. Vandaag vindt Philips de digitale compactcassette en de portable DCC-speler uit, waarmee je zelfs bestaande cassettes kan afspelen. Tijden veranderen. Perfect CD-geluid op cassette, waar je ook bent.
I dig it.
Philips invents for you.
Its technical interest is that it uses stationary heads, like the compact cassette, 9-track magneto-resistive head for playback and 9 for recording, plus 2 for playing conventional cassettes. A to B flips the heads to change the playback size. Portable devices are exceptions to this because they have fixed heads and contain the heads for both sides. It uses busk encoding for recording, precision adaptive subband coding. The incoming sound divided into 32 subfrequencies by digital filters, and the system always decides how many bits should be used where. The bitrate is 384 kilobits per second with about 4 to 1 compression. System information is added to this and the Reed Solomon error correction bits, so the total amount of data on the cassette is 768 kilobits per second, and distributes this to the 8 recording heads. In theory, at least according to Philips, the sound can be restored even if one complete recording track cannot be read or there is a complete loss of signal for up to 3/100 of a second. This busk encoding is the basis of the MP1 audio format. It's just not limited to 384 kilobit per second. The possible sampling frequencies are 32, 44.1 and 48 kHz, but only 44.1 kHz can be used from analog source. The 9th recording track on the pre-recorded cassettes contains album, title and time information along the entire length of the tape. These informations are available on any point of an audio track. In the case of empty cassettes, all decks record markers and they are also automatically recognize the break, but only the 730 and the 951 could add title names after the recording, and only the track title that is currently playing can be displayed. In the 1990s, the music industry started to force copy protection on the media. Two bits were used for this: protected or unprotected, and original or copy. If both the protected and copy bits are on, then the recording is not possible, so stops with an error message. If the status is protected and original, then it replaces the original bit with a copy and authorizes this copy. There is no copy protection on the analog input. DCC cassettes
has chrome dioxide tape
with slightly better mechanics from traditional cassette tapes, because more precise type guidance is required to keep digital tracks. There are some extra holes on the edge, and the machine knows from these that is a DCC tape and its length. Therefore, some higher quality chrome cassettes, by drilling in the right place, the machine can be hacked and records on it digitally. This is the first generation mid-range model, the DCC 600. It sounds pretty good. I think it also plays analog tapes more clearly compared to traditional tape recorders. When it was launched in 1992, that was no longer the main rival, but Sony's Minidisc. Quite a usable and small optical disc. And next to each other on the shows or stores, only one behavior was very obvious. I show you. The Marantz DCC 175 portable and the Philips version of it was only the
versions
that could be connected to a computer using a PC link cable to the serial port. It could only be used with IBM machines and was only made for the Dutch market. Writing 250 megabytes to the tape took in about 90 minutes, which is considered too slow even that time. DCC Studio program was available, which could be used to copy audio from tape to hard drive and back.
Finally, DCC wasn't successful, although the sound quality was quite good, but it turned out to be much more expensive than planned. People were not in a hurry to switch. One of the biggest advantages, and also a disadvantage, compatible with compact cassettes, but it doesn't record in analog, which was missed by many people, including me. And in the case of the digital part, the tape is tape, so there is no random access. Philips failed to lower the price and couldn't find other manufacturers to support the format. So in 1996, Philips stopped the production of DCC. Thank you for watching. Please press like, subscribe, bye!